wide skipper leads his team onto the field.
As an eager crowd watch, we see Boss Williams, dynamic Mr. Football, lead his team onto the field.
Umpire Sweeney moving in. There it is. Zucker and McGregor. McGregor under it. He has it. He kicks it out of trouble. Wonky's after it, showing pace. He comes through. He's lost it. He's got it again, and he's clearing for port. Shocking kick, though, out of bounds. Boss Williams gets it in. He's on his knees. Clever hand pass to Gill with a long driving left foot kick. It's in off all hands, and Tommy Williams has put it through for an effortless goal. At this stage, it's anybody's game, with the scores being West Adelaide 13-6, Port Adelaide 12, goals 9. That's the centre bounce now. It's gone down. Eglinton's trying for it. Motley well into the play again. Costello is showing his customary dash down in West Adelaide's half forward line. Now Motley, he's by himself, flicks it over his head to Foss Williams, who swoops on it like a seagull. Colin Brown lost a lot of pace, still flashing around there. Kicks a short one into centre half forward. Everyone's in the air. No one has it. But he's played McGregor. And Port players run the ground everywhere. Players are converging. This is the first incident that's marred today's play. Now McGregor's hooked it across into the centre of the ground to find Colin Brown. There goes Colin Brown running in for the kick. It's a long one. It's screwing in. Is it? No, it falls short. Someone has it. We can't see who. And umpire Sweeney does the right thing and calls up the ball. And there goes the final siren, and it's Port Adelaide again for the fifth successive year, creating an Australian record, a South Australian and an Australian record. Listen to that crowd go mad. People are converging on the players from all over the oval. There's no let-up. Thousands of them, literally thousands, running onto the ground to cheer off the Port players, and they really deserve their victory today.
Can we go right back to your first real season with Westies?
Well, we had 2 years with North Whaler then as captain coach. I went there to, I don't know why I went there, but they offered me a few dollars and they offered me a good job so with one of the building companies. And so I went there and, yeah, well, we won a couple of premierships there. And that's where I met Barb, my wife. She was very lucky. And I came along. And that was 60 years ago, actually. Yeah. And then, of course, I came down and played. During that period, I came down and played one more game at Westies, which I shouldn't have done because that tied me for a further 3 years. I didn't know that. I found that out later.
I knew that.
Because when I left Wales, I accepted a playing coaching job at East Gambier. And West wouldn't clear me. So I stopped and played at West Adelaide.
Today at the Adelaide Oval, we watch some 40 players out on the arena in very trying conditions, doing their very utmost and giving spectators a wonderful treat of football. It's a pity that both their sides can't win, but both North and West Adelaide deserve the premiership. But it is West Adelaide's turn this year, and in their fifth attempt in the last 7 years, they have at last won the grand final. And it's congratulations to an outstanding footballer in Neil Kirby. Congratulations, Neil, on a mighty fine win today, you and the boys.
Thank you, Arnold. Thank you.
As you can see, Neil is a very tired player. How did you find conditions out there today, Neil?
Oh, they were the worst I've ever played under today. They were very hot, and the ground was hard, and I think everyone was waiting for that final bell in the last quarter.
Well, they were terrific, considering that you outscored Norwood by 8 points in that third quarter and led by 18 points at the last change. You must have felt pretty happy.
Yes, I was quite confident we would win when we were leading in the coming to the last quarter. But West Adelaide have been in these positions before over the years, and they've gone on to lose them. But this year, they're the best team I've ever played with, and they were really in there pitching in the last quarter.
They certainly were, Neil, and it's been a terrific year for you. Congratulations, your first year in league company as a coach. Not only that, you won the award last night as the player of most value in to a club. You also captained a very good carnival side in Brisbane, and now you've taken West Adelaide to a premiership. You must be particularly happy.
Yes, I'm very happy tonight, thank you. It's the happiest moment in my sporting life. We won today.
Thanks, Neil.
Let's start with how you got into footy. What were your sort of earliest memories and what you wanted to do with footy? Lindsay, you're the oldest.
Thanks for that, Keith. Yes. Well, I was born within a couple of drop kicks of the Thebe Oval. You know, I sort of grew up with a football going to bed, you know, and because I went to Thebe Primary and then Theberton Tech, my whole sporting career was around the Theberton Oval. And I was picked in the state schoolboy side when I was 11. Jeff Motley was in it as well, and we went 2 days and three nights on the train to Perth for a fortnight for a carnival, and that really started it. And then I started playing with the Colts, and used to train at the old Hindmarsh Oval, where the soccer is now, and that's where I started. And I was then training at Theberton Oval, and they took me up when I was 15 to train with the league side. I played senior Colts, I didn't play junior Colts, I played senior Colts, and they used to play in front of the league side, in front of the league game on Saturdays. And anyway, they took me up to train with them, and then they decided they were going to pick me. So this was when I was 16, and they went over to home and asked my mother and father whether it was okay. And Mum said, "Oh no, he's too young." And Dad said, "If he's good enough, pick him." And I said to Mum, I said, "Don't worry, Mum." I said, "I only get one game anyway, so don't worry about it." And then I played 327 after that, so it was pretty good.
And held the record for a very long time.
Yeah, Paul Bagshaw came along and beat it, you know. Mm. But I was the first one to play 300 games in South Australia, which I was very proud of at the time.
Did you really reckon you might have only played one game?
Oh, you know, I had to be good to my mother. I can remember when I was very young and you couldn't get footballs during the war, and my mum walked Adelaide to try to buy me a football, because we used to kick newspaper around the place, and you know, rolled up newspaper and tied up with string as a football. And she walked Adelaide to find a footy, and she found one, didn't have enough money to get home in the tram, so she walked all the way home. So that's the sacrifices they made for us.
John, you got a similar story about being spotted early.
Yeah, very much the same background as Lindsay. The family were very much into sport and into football. I had an older brother, and I just used to have to work with him and compete against him in the backyard for a kick with Dad mainly. And
kicking in the car park in the Hyde Park Hotel.
We used to go over to the Hyde Park Hotel. We lived opposite that, and then up to Haywood Park, which was just up the road, and then of course straight into Unley Primary School, and through Unley Primary, much a similar background to Lindsay. I was lucky to get in the state schoolboys team, a primary school team, at the age of 11, and we played our carnival in Adelaide in 1949. And then I went to Unley High School, where there was a very strong sporting tradition, if you like. Went right through school, finished school, and then had no intention really of worrying about the Sturt Football Club. I'd played a couple of Colts games, but I played all my football at high school. And then I got named to play in a trial game, even though I'd never been near the club that year. And Mum said, "You better go and have a run and see how you go."
So how old are you now?
17. And so I went and had a run, and they put me in the what we call the scrubbers trial at 12 o'clock. And then I played all right in that, and I went next week into the main trial, and then 2 weeks later into the league side.
Mm.
So it was much, much a similar beginning of growing up in a family where football was important or was regarded as the thing that you did as a kid if you were going to play sport. Got encouragement from home to do that, and then I went from there.
Barry, you weren't exactly close to the Prospect Oval, were you?
No. No, but I was very close to the Memorial Oval at Whyalla, and that was almost my second home growing up, because it was close. It was within walking distance, maybe half a kilometre away, that was all. And the school, the primary school that I attended, was right next door to that oval. So I guess almost my three homes were my actual home, the Memorial Oval and the Whyalla South Primary School, although back then it was called the Memorial Oval Primary School. And I spent a lot of my time away from home at those other two venues, just practicing and watching and learning. And I developed an affinity to the North Whyalla Football Club, where I played all my junior football and 2 years of senior football before coming down to play for the club that Donald Lindner played for.
Down for the second semi-final between Port and Torrens, and a terrific knockaway by Hannaford goes out to the centre wing. Players taking place on the centre wing. A beautiful handball by Obst across to Erie. Erie's chasing the ball down in front of the grandstand side. Out the ball goes to the forward pocket for Port Adelaide, smartly into attack at the beginning of this first quarter, and a kick goes out of bounds. Following a lovely pass from Ops, who came well down over centre to mark that. He had no trouble in finding Motley, and Motley shoots away from goal from centre half forward. Not a very good kick. It's off hands. Potter's picked it up. He turns quickly and shoots for goal for Port Adelaide, and there's the first goal on the board from Potter. Terrific scrimmage going on. Bills has it. Handballs it out. Torrens are desperately trying to clear this away. It comes to Motley. Motley goes in and shoots for goal from the half forward line, and it's through. It's the third goal to Port Adelaide. A long shot by Motley. And out in front is Livesey. Almost brings it down. Handballs to Shearman. Shearman goes past. Eludes Erie. Plays on quickly. And a long soaring drop kick has gone right down into the attacking zone for Torrens. They're playing well. And here's Head, the McGarry medalist, running into an open goal. And up comes another goal for Torrens. Still a chance for Torrens to break away and clear here. A punch down by Braidwood looking for Rawson. Rawson has got it, but he's in trouble. Coming back is Bray, and Bray's left foot kick is through for a goal, the fourth goal for Port Adelaide. Shooting for goal, and it's a beauty too. It's straight through the middle, and that brings up Port Adelaide's eighth goal. They now go to 8-18, Torrens 6-11. The siren has gone to complete the second semi-final, with Port Adelaide being the victors, 9-18 to 7-13.
How did you come to be at Port Adelaide?
Born and bred in the district. I think my parents the day I was born, put black and white socks on me. And when I was delivered, they came on along with me for that period of time, I suppose. But I was born and bred in Port Adelaide, as about 2 kilometres from the Albert and Oval. So I was always going to be Port Adelaide, and growing up I always wanted to be Port Adelaide, as everyone else in our area in the Port Adelaide district became as time went forward.
Was sport your great love? Did you play all sports? Was football the best thing, the most important thing?
I was the same as any kid that grew up at that time. We played cricket, football, tennis, whatever there was about the place, that was part of it. But as time went forward, I went closer to the football side of it more than anything else. At primary school, I did play in the state cricket team as a batsman and a wicketkeeper that they had at that age, but then I gave it away because I couldn't stand the cricket side of it, sitting and watching them all day with nothing to do while they had a bat, and I gave it away and stuck virtually solely to football and probably water skiing.
And also, you were a very fair player. You never got into trouble with referees. You just got on with it. Was something inside you? Was it through your family that you were that sort of person?
No, I was well aware that umpires, I've been following the game now for many, many, many years, but I've never ever seen an umpire change his decision. So going crooked at an umpire was, in my opinion, it was just a waste of time. I didn't bother with it. And whoever judged me as fair and all that, well, I'm quite kosher with that, but that was just part and parcel of the way I played the game. I reckon my anger needed to go on the ball, not the player.
Ten minutes into the first quarter, and South Adelaide with another opportunity. Alexander shooting in. It's going to fall short of goal. Up they go. Comes down off the hands of the pack. Darley has it. Handballs out. White tries to gather it in. Here's a kick in by Backman. And Backman has scored the first goal of the match. And it goes to South Adelaide. And here are South Adelaide going right down to their full forward area. It's over the head of the pack. Now here's a pickup by White and a very hurried shot into goal, and that is South Adelaide's first goal of the quarter. In fact, it's the first goal for either side for the quarter. And 6 minutes into the third quarter, Port Adelaide have a chance for goal, and there is a goal scored by Freeman, I think it is. And that is the end of the match, with South Adelaide scoring a magnificent win. South Adelaide 9 goals 15, 69 points, defeating Port Adelaide 5 goals 12, 42 points. And there is Curley, who's done a magnificent job to bring South Adelaide from bottom to top in one season. He's done this before. He did this at Whyalla in his early days in football, and did the same for West Adelaide in his first year of coaching for the Red and Blacks. And now he's done it again with South Adelaide, and they thoroughly deserve this magnificent 27-point win over Port Adelaide.
Brian, welcome from the Adelaide Hills down to our history department. It's fantastic to talk to you now. 222 games, 1944 to 1956, centre-half back and a few games as ruckman. Who was it at the club that really helped you to develop to be a star player in those days, including the premiership times?
Well, I used to get, because we trained, poor West Adelaide, we didn't have an oval, and we used to train at the number 2 ground at the back of the Adelaide Oval. And there I got quite a bit of help from Bruce McGregor. He was a big star in the old days. He used to come down and help you with the techniques of playing, you know, cricket and handball and all that sort of thing, and kicking and straightening out all your little problems and the intensity. It was good. He was a big help to me. And then we had a chap called Gordon Scott, Wacker Scott they used to call him, who was appointed coach in 1946. And he really gave the team a big lift with his style and the way we played. And then 47, because we won the premiership. So
And Foz Williams was in that 47 premiership with you. What was it like playing with Foz?
Oh, that way, it was early days for Foz. Yeah. I mean, he wasn't a star like he was later on, you know, because he was just really learning the more refinements of the game. And he was a rover and just one of the group, you know. Yeah.
It's really interesting regarding Foz Williams, because he played with you and against you. This is talking about you. Your nickname was Iron Man. I've never met a better teammate or a more ferocious and determined opponent, which is a bit of a rap coming from Foz Williams.
Yes. Mm. Well, it's a bit of a story there too. Because when he went to Port Adelaide, over the trauma at the club, and it should never have gone there, but so our committee was weak and let him go, because they had to get a clearance from the club to go in those days. And our silly committee at that stage just let him go. So anyway, because I was playing at centre half back, in those days a lot, when Foss was playing for Port, the centre bounce, you know, a knockout the rover, and of course, the rover would start to go. And you're always aware of that, so I was always aware that as soon as he got the ball, I went to meet him. And that was their style then, so it was a good game though, yeah.
Yes, Mick Rivers, he had a touch of cramp. I think Blair noticed him early. A kick from Lester Ross, up to the teeth of goal. Roberts in there, he can't mark it. Comes down off hands, White breaks his way clear, shoots a goal, it's a goal, and there's one kick the difference. What a magnificent game this is, and that's White's third goal for the game.
Here it comes out, Mal Whitford, a beautiful mark. I was just thinking, what will South say if they lose? Will they say, Mal Whitford, you shouldn't have done that short pass, but there was a good bit of play by Whitford. In it comes to 21, Lester Ross, the man who kicks round corners. And look at the crowd go mad. Lester Ross. Lester Ross, as I said, the man who kicked round corners. There he is. And Beaufort is on the half forward left position. His kick, not a bad drop kick, comes up the crowd. Big men fly, and someone's taken a mark by the look of this. No, he's taken it away and from Big Steve Traynor. No, he hasn't. He's given it to him, of course. And the mark will be taken by Steve Traynor. 50 yards out. He certainly got the distance. He certainly got the direction. And once again, with this magnificent Port comeback, Port go to a 6-point lead. Steve Traynor has kicked his fourth goal. He's playing it on. Comes out to White. White sends it on down to Pasco. Pasco trying to steady himself, and he'd be a hero. And he's done it. Pasco has kicked a goal for South Adelaide, and South Adelaide hits the front as Mead breaks clear. Is tackled by Schmidt. Comes down. And a free kick has been given
to
Port Adelaide with 3 seconds to go.
Well, they're either going to win it by 5 points or it's going out of bounds. There's 1 point the difference, 107 to South, 106 to Port Adelaide. And here's the player, Mead, to take his kick. He's 55 to 60 yards out. I don't think he can get the distance. He got a goal. He's got a goal, and they've won it. Port Adelaide have won this game. That went through. Port Adelaide have won by 5 points. What a fantastic finish to this game.
Hooky Neal from the throw-in with Roberts and also Clarkson in there from the throw-in. From the tap down, it comes over to Curley. Curley puts it into attack again. It's going up. Cantilla and Jarrett off hands. It's Cantilla! Yes, it's Cantilla. Oh, he's... Hey,
what is
hey. Yeah, can't... Oh, I beg your pardon. That's an amazing bit of the... it's play on, and it's Clark running up along the wing. He's bouncing the ball. He's going for a short pass across to Darryl Hicks, and he's found him in the centre of the ground. And This is the most amazing scenes down here as Hicks plays on quickly and Halbert's free in the forward pocket. He's marked the ball right in the forward right pocket and he's 45 yards out. Halbert, he's already kicked six and he's got a chance to kick seven. And if he kicks his seven, Souths are in a very tight spot. John Halbert, he's got all the time in the world. He's going to make sure of this one. As he kicks the ball, it's going to drop short. But it's Emmy Jones in front, and he's right in the 10-yard area. And I think everybody except Emmy Jones was fooled by John Halbert's kick there. The drop very short. And I can guarantee you, with the way Emmy Jones kicks at goal, he won't miss this. He's right back in front, and this is his fifth goal. It's right through the middle, and that's given Sturt a seven-point break with 7 minutes to go. And at this stage, they must be very happy indeed, although no doubt they can't stop trying. Puts the ball onto his boot, up towards centre-half forward position, and there's only 45 seconds to go. Souths can't do it from here. Comes down off, hands to Hallett. Hallett up towards goal. Skuse leading in the race to the ball, but the ball and the clock's going to beat them all as Cunningham gets to it first, over to Short, and you can bet your life that Sturt are going into the grand final as Clark takes a mark. Whitford up there, he breaks his way clear, he's legged, but there's only 5 seconds to go and the game is all over. 7 points the difference, and you can see Odie down there, Jack Odie, he's dancing for joy as it's Sturt all the way, and they go to meet Port in the grand final next week with 2 seconds to go. There's the final siren. Congratulations to Sturt. And you can hear, you can see the Sturt players there, deliriously happy. And while I am naturally disappointed, being a South Adelaide man, congratulations to Sturt. You were the better side on the day, and all the very best in the grand final against Port Adelaide.
Lee, I know you don't like talking about your football years and all that, particularly because we're here to talk about the league, but just take us back to the playing years of Lee Wicker.
Well, I think I was fortunate, like a lot of young men that came to the Sturt Football Club under Coach Jack Otie, because Jack was a marvellous mentor and a very caring person, not only about the footballer, but the person and his own personal life and career path. And I think that was probably the most significant benefit that I achieved out of being at the Sturt Football Club, aside from having a few games with some wonderful, wonderful people.
Yeah, though, but you came at a time when the Sturt Footy Club, well, when you watched them as a kid, were you a Sturt supporter?
Absolutely.
Well, you were like me. We were coming bottom a lot.
Well, I've still got our scrapbooks at home back in the 50s. And I can probably recite the whole team back in the 50s, which I won't attempt to do now. But that's, I go back as a young man supporting the club all through my early days.
Go to the footy every week?
Absolutely.
Mm. Yeah, so you were dedicated to the SANFL as a kid and you found yourself going into Sturt. Was there a plan? Did you want to be a league footballer?
No, I played for Blackwood up in the Adelaide Hills, and a guy called Alan Fenn, who was the recruiting manager for the Sturt Football Club, knocked on my father's door one day because I was having a bit of success as a young man playing in the Glenelg South West district, as it was then, not the Sturt district, and invited me down to training. And I said, I don't want to go down there. I want to stay with my mates at Blackwood. But as history saw, I went down eventually and never looked back. In fact, I was very lucky. I played for the thirds in the early days under Len Fitzgerald, and that was a mark, because I just admired him.
For young people, you might remind us just how important that name is.
Well, Len Fitzgerald, before his time, if he was playing today, he was up with the best. He'd be there equally to the best today. He was a marvellous footballer. Came across in his early years, and of course
from Victoria.
From Victoria, it's history now to what Len Fitzgerald meant to the Sturt Football Club in South Australia.
Throw-in, we will see Malcolm Hill and Kevin Salmon. Down it comes. Tilbrook takes it very coolly, kicks it back, eludes a number of players, comes down to Jeff Potter. He gets his boot to the ball quickly, comes out to half forward. That would be one of the most miraculous marks I've ever seen and Murphy plays on straight into the arms of Darrell Hicks at centre half forward. My gosh, I hope to see that Murphy mark in the replay. But let's watch Hicks. He's at centre half forward. I don't think he can get the distance from here. And to bring you up to date, 3 minutes to go.
3 minutes
3 points
remaining.
The difference. Hicks is saying, I'm not kicking it till you give me the chance. He's sent it out to Hill. Hill onto Brenton Adcock. And Brenton Adcock once again muffs his chance. Sends the ball right out of bounds, and Ian Day says, oh no, the ruckman will be Clarkson and Phil Clarkson. Hicks on to Erie. Erie, however, waits for it, gets it down. There is Thomas. Back it goes to Thomas. Thomas sends Sturt into attack, off the about three hands. Motley, and finally it is Bagshaw, who is caught with the ball, and the... What's happened is
wait
all
up,
over.
There's a free.
There's a free kick.
And the police are not much police. Worse their while here.
I haven't heard the siren. Is it gone?
Well,
it's all over.
What amazing scenes here at the Adelaide Oval. The crowd was roaring so hard that no one could hear the final bell, but umpire Cunningham's whistled it over and the record goes down. That Port Adelaide have won the 1965 Grand Final, and it must surely rank as the greatest Grand Final game in history. As it turned out, Port Adelaide won 19 of the 22 games they played this year, and there you can see Foster Williams being cheered off, and they are to be fully congratulated on a magnificent win.
Tell us about the early days under Foss.
Under Foss, Foss was a very hard coach, but he could do everything that he asked you to do. If it was a 50-50 ball, we had to win it. That was what Foss demanded. So it was more about attack on the ball. And then we tackled well as that. He wasn't really into the skills that much. Jack Odie was into the skills, and I thought Neil Curley gave leadership. So if you ask me what I learnt from the three coaches, commitment from Foss, you know, everything was 100%. Mm. You sacrifice, you give it all. The skills really came from Jack Odie. He was into the handball. He saw it before other people did. And then I thought the leadership playing against Curley on the ground, he was a born leader. So, you know, I was lucky to have three excellent coaches to be able to pick brains and use it in my coaching career.
Points Sturt, 7 goals, 8, 50 points. Port Adelaide, the throw in the pocket. Tapped down by Hill to Rigney. Rigney snaps towards goal and it's the crowd roars and Sturt have kicked 105 points. They passed the century, I don't know how many times this season.
Shearman getting a great round of applause as Chessel puts in a magnificent drop kick in front. It's Halbert! And look at that laugh all over John Halbert's face, and he's certainly got plenty to be grinning about. Right in front of goals, he's about to make them 16 goals, 15. 111 points, look at them.
John Murphy in there with Jeffrey Potter. Potter getting the ball away, down towards the half forward line. Out they come. It was Steve Traynor in trouble before as McKay shoots goalwards. This is the homer for Port Adelaide as they refuse to give in. They kicked their first score for some time. 8 goals, 8 go Port Adelaide. Chasing Sturt, 16 goals, 16.
Someone throwing his arms in the air. Spencer, it was there. It's taken by Short. He'd have to be one of their good players as he puts it across to Rigney. Rigney puts it across towards the centre wing where Miles pulls it in, and there's a siren. And Sturt.
Let's see if they can keep the crowd off the ground.
It's a great corn.
A great gesture by Trevorov as he goes to John Halbert. What a fitting result for John Halbert in his last years in football, shortly after winning a McGarry medal.
Jack Odie. Jack Odie.
Being carried by the horse, Diamond Jim Tilbrook.
It's grand final time again, and the scene is Adelaide Oval, where a capacity crowd of nearly 59,000 people were ready to watch the battle for the premiership between Port Adelaide and Sturt. Brilliant sunshine greeted the Sturt players as they ran onto the ground, led by acting captain John Murphy. A few minutes later, Port Adelaide, led by skipper John Cale, ran onto the ground to take part in one of the most exciting grand finals ever.
There's Zach Clarkson, gets a beautiful tap down behind the pack, finds Rigney. Rigney running through strongly at the centre of the ground, goes towards centre half forward. Bagshaw, well scored by Cooper, doesn't come through, looks for someone to handball it to, no one there. Looks it towards the goal square, Emmy Jones is up. Out of the half-forward flank and a mark by Beaufoy. Hand passed on by Beaufoy. This is tremendous football as Haslam drives one in. Broadbridge in front. The knockdown finds Leal. Leal is bumped off it by Adcock. The ball picked up by Gill. And the kick by Gill has gone through for a goal. And Port Adelaide are coming back. Dave Gill getting only about his second kick so far. The kick by Cale is screwing in towards the goals. It's going to be there. It's gone through.
It's a goal. Fantastic goal from John Cale.
It's a high punt kick which is standing on end. We go to the 2 minute of the time on period and it's marked here by Clayton, centre half back.
It
hasn't been paid. Hasn't been paid. He has to kick around his body to the half back flank. Taken here by Erie. Erie kicks towards Holmes. Holmes mishandles. Taken here by Tilbrook. Ducks his head, tries to go through and he'll be paid the free kick for around the neck.
5 points the difference.
Port Adelaide players turning around him. Here's a kick by Dunn. And this time it's going to go straight through. Kick by Roger Dunn. And that would just about sew it up. Sturt at 13 goals 10. 13 goals 10 at 88 points. Got up in the last few minutes of the final term to defeat Port Adelaide at 10 goals 17 at 77 points. And what a magnificent finish.
Alan, welcome. It's a delight to be chatting to you. And I think it's probably about 50 years that you turned up at the Elizabeth Club. Was it 1966 as a talented young player?
Yes. In the 1966, I was invited out to be involved with the under-17s. And that was my first connection, really, with the SANFL. And very fortunate with a group of young men from the area, Sourceby, Sourceby North, Elizabeth. And we won the flag that year against Woodville, and a lot of boys from that team actually graduated through the ranks and played for Central. So that was my first connection with the club and the Colts in 1966.
And who were some of the players that went on to have a very good career? You had a couple of bad injuries, didn't you, which knocked you around?
I had a bad thigh injury after I'd played a couple of league games and it didn't quite work for me. But in that particular team, Richard Cochran, Dean Farnham, Rodney Hagee, Julian Swinstead, Tim Jackson, and I've probably missed three or four. I think there were about 10 or 12 players that went on and played some senior football, which is a fair group to actually progress through to league footy from a Colts team.
Thrilling final term here in the first semi-final at Adelaide Oval. Saywell said himself, hasn't done a thing all day. He's been a disappointment. In there is Davies, but it's Saywell that gets it away with the ball, gets it onto his left foot. That's one of his very few kicks. Over to the centre half forward position. Centrals have got the run of it now. Who's going to take it? It's Norsworthy. Tried to get the hand passed over to Jones on his own in the square. It went unstuck. Picked up by Mobbs. Back to Norsworthy. Norsworthy to Mulholland. Mulholland steps for goal and through.
Well done. Well done, the little fellows. That makes 8 goals, 10 Central District, 58, 1 point in front, 7 goals, 15.
Central District at this stage finishing on a bit better than Sturt. Torn from the half-forward flank position, got a bit of distance with the kick. Chance for Davies to take the mark. He was pushed off at the left. Oh, it's a goal.
Mulholland, well done. 3 goals, Mulholland. 23 kicks, 3 goals, and he's put his side in front again. 9-10 in front for Sturt, 7-16.
Slipped over. Bad luck then for Adcock as he had a clear run ahead of him. The ball comes out the way of Mulholland. Mulholland shoots. The kick is on the way. It's a goal.
And Mulholland has 26 kicks. All goals on the board.
2 goals in this quarter. Awkward bounce there for Sturt as Andrews comes through. Back to Vivian. Vivian steadies the left foot kick up to try to find Mobbs. The ball bounced in front of him. Adcock with the ball now. Try to get the hand pass away. Comes over to Wiley. Wiley to Mulholland. Mulholland going goalwards. And it's a goal. sounds. You can see Dennis Jones in the Channel 9 screen, Jimmy Sawford and Norm Russell, the excited Dennis Jones, and as well he might. Have a look at that final scoreboard, 91 points. There he is being hoisted aloft, 91 points to 64. There were no ifs or buts or arguments of any description. Sturts were beaten at their own game by superior use of skill. Wouldn't you have loved it, Wally? There's the bounce. Thorne gets the thap down, knocked on by Phillips, taken by Johnny Cale. There's a Port Adelaide Guernsey there and he's marked it. Who is it? I think it's Haslam. Haslam's got the cramp badly. There you can see he's trying to drive his heel down into the ground to cure that cramp. He got a shocking knock at the other end of the ground back about 10 or 15 minutes ago. It took three trainers to get him to his feet and he didn't look like resume. He got a shocking knock in the groin. I think he's whacked it through. He's put it through for a goal and Port Adelaide still couldn't win it, but by heavens, they're coming home.
As the ball comes back into place, Bourne taps it away, pulls across there, so is John Cale, can't get to it. Picked up there by Boydwich. The quick hand pass was a beauty. The snap's on its way towards the goal. Umpire gets in the right-hand place and it's moved. A major goes up for Port Adelaide.
Hill plays it on from the half-back line, kicks up towards centre wing. Barry Robren's got it, and Barry Robren, I would reckon, would take 3 minutes to kick the ball if he's got any brain. Here's his kick on towards the half-forward flank. Thumped away, off hands comes to Nyland.
There goes Cesaro. There's Cesaro to end the 1971 Premiership. The victory goes to North Adelaide.
Trying to relieve the pressure as the ball comes back towards the half-back. A chance for Robren, he's got it.
It's taken by Sadler. He gets it to Webb. Webb into an open goal. North Adelaide are in front. But it's taken here by North Adelaide. Across it goes to Marsh. Marsh now towards the weak position. And Webb has marked. Webb has taken the mark on the weak position. Half a minute to go, they tell me. Webb has got the ball in the weak position on the member stand side. What a boil over this is. Webb, it goes off the side of his boot. And the siren's gone. North Adelaide have won it. Won two premierships in a row with North Adelaide. And he's won the Australian Championship. Well done, Patterson. Well done, North Adelaide. Carlton, we're proud of your courageous effort. A very courageous effort from Carlton. But look at this, Louis. You can't believe your eyes.
Well, certainly a great win by North Adelaide. Of course, they're $10,000 in front too, which would make the boys very happy. But we must give full credit to North Adelaide. And a great performance put up by number 10 of North Adelaide, Barry Robram. He leads, played a great game.
Thompson now out towards the left half-back flank, 45 metres. Corns with a great leap up in the air. Wonderful. 15 metres. Silly play there by Matthews. Nothing intentional, nothing malicious about it, but should have let him go because Corns is within distance, and Corns, who has kicked one, kicked a magnificent goal early in the match when it covered the best part of 75, 80 metres running through.
In fairness to Matthews, Corns always plays on, and I think he was about to do so then.
Corns has kicked a goal.
Well done. He's been a good run on Ruckman, no doubt about that. He's kicked his second goal.
Kicked forward by Richardson towards the half-forward line, and in front, the good mark's taken and playing on
Davis. Davis kicks out towards the half-forward flank, and they've got away Victoria, and they rip their way into attack as the big kick goes on from Fletcher. Could be his second goal from those wings.
Well done, and well done, Victoria. And the siren, I believe, has gone. The goal's on the board, and Victoria win by 4 points. And I see the Victorian players going and congratulating umpire Capes, and I believe that's the thing they should do.
Graham, fantastic to have a legend of the SANFL to have a little bit of a window on what you've been up to. Let's go right back to early days of...
I'd been able to play while I was in the army, but I just sort of fly in, fly out. That wasn't very satisfactory. So under Curls we played 69, 70, 73, 74, 75. Only won one of them, unfortunately.
And yeah, it's all very well, but I mean, Jack Odie says that the last final that they won of the run, 1970, he says that was the hardest of the lot. So you obviously were close.
I'd been back from Vietnam about 3 weeks, three or 4 weeks, and that was the really wet, rainy day, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, we just didn't have the mental capacity to overcome Sturt's finals experience. You know, we were too inexperienced, unfortunately.
By 73, you do win it, and it is obviously huge for the Bays.
Mm. Yeah. Well, we nearly didn't win it. I mean, there was 71, 72 had been quite hard years, but we Kerr's brought in a fitness advisor called Billy Neal, and he was the difference. A conduit between the playing group and Neil Curley, as well as enhancing our fitness. And so we knew any grand final we got to, there could not be any alternative other than to win. We're playing North Adelaide, who'd won the two previous grand finals. Mm. We'd only lost one game for the year, and that was against North Adelaide at Prospect, when Peter Marker and myself had been injured during the game. But so there was only one, it was a hot northerly wind, it was a horrible day really, and we were comfortable. It was a hard game, we were leading at three quarter time, and then they just came over the top of us, you know, kicked that goal in time on, and we thought, oh no, not again.
So you're 5 points down.
5 points down.
Before deep the in mark in, for which you are most famous.
Five points down deep into time on, and I hadn't had a great game. It was just nothing really. I was changing with Peter Marker on the half forward flank. Nothing really went our way. We'd had some great performers. Peter Carey played a sensational game at centre half forward. Rexy Voigt had kicked seven goals and had one disallowed. He should have kicked eight. You know, Bob Tardiff had rucked all day. So I'd cramped up, nearly in the, just cramped up, and went to the forward pocket. And then Craig Merritt had come on as the 20th man, raced around the, picked the ball up and just kicked it high, and I just had to do something. It was just like just for crying out loud, do something. So, and somehow the ball just stuck between my chin and my chest, and had to go back then and kick the goal. So
now that there's no pressure, of course.
No pressure.
but you did have a way of doing it. Just take us. How did you kick the goal?
Well, I've fallen on the balls in the hands, and I think, why me? I realised the enormity of it, why me? Sort of stuff you dream about. So I've gone back and I've walked back, and you look at vision now and I'm dishevelled, and my socks are down, I'm exhausted. And when I turned around, there was a tree between the, right in the middle of the goal square. So they always used to say, look, line up something behind the goal square and kick for that. And there was this tree, and there's these kids in the tree, and they're all sort of holding. So I sort of just, It wasn't a very convincing kick, but it actually went straight. So luckily, bang, it went straight. But then we still had to. The game hadn't ended. We still had to, because there was a Jimmy Rawson smother. There was a Brian Colby run. There was, and the ball came down again. I actually got my hands to it and dropped it. But then, bang, it came back down again, and Johnny Sandland marked it, and the siren went. So.
I mean,
one point up in the siren when Sandy kicked the ball after we won by 7 points. It was just, oh, unbelievable. It was just relief.
It wasn't just you guys. Wally May thought it was probably the greatest grand final he'd ever seen. I think Elbows Aitken thought the same thing.
Well, if you go back and look at the vision of it, which you can these days with YouTube and stuff, the game stands up really well by modern day comparison. Just a bit more open, of course. Oh, and then all pandemonium occurred because the crowd came over the fence and we were just crushed by this crowd. We
couldn't get a victory lap in.
Well, we sort of did, but it was like in single file. it was just amazing relief. And, you know, all these people at Glenelg crying, and the civic reception at the town hall and back at the club.
It's 39 years, isn't it? I think it was 39 years. Yeah. I think it was 1934 was the last premiership. So.
34 to 73.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kick away from Robinson. Up. Barry Robbins had a quiet one. Corbs kicks it. Taken by Voigt. Voigt snaps for the goals. It's 6 points, and you can hear the roar from here. Corns' long kick down to the forward pocket. Voigt again, knocked away by Robinson. Voigt sticks to it. Handball over, comes to Fred Phillips. Handball over, Carey, and Stewart goes for his sixth goal for the day.
15 points in front are the Bays. Rodney Robinson, centre half forward, comes in and drives it on its way.
Won't quite. It's over the top and through for goal. Listen to that roar from the 56,000 people as he steers it up there. Sacked!
He's got away. 7 points the difference, 6 points the difference. At 1 point the difference now.
Steadies, Colby's gone, they're all gone.
on towards centre half forward. Up goes Freddie Phillips. The brilliant Robin. Here he goes. Steady for Donald Gray. It's going to go off the boat. And the goal. Oh, they're going to win this ball, Adelaide.
2 minutes of time on. He's really cramped as he comes in for this one. Through it goes. And full marks then to Barry Robin, who got the ball there. Sash goes down. Picked up by Marriott. Marriott hooks it up in front of the goals. He's gone.
Oh, what a launch
for the week of the season. It's a heart failure finish. He's back to three. And the Bays go back to the front. We've had 5 minutes of time on.
Hand passes on. Taken there by Miller, who pops at the wrong time. Back it goes to Frederick Phillips. Sets himself right down towards the square. It goes. There's only about 30, 60 seconds left.
Since 1934, and it's only academic that Sandland has whacked through another goal to give him 4-3 for the day. And you've seen one of the best grand finals for many, many years, with at the finish the Bays winning it by 7 points with a goal after the siren. And what fantastic scenes we're seeing here in front of the members stand. The Bays winning by 7 points, and what a mighty grand final that was.
Through comes Stringer, been a quiet player in the last three quarters, taken now by Richard Cochran, kicks in towards the goals. Howard trying the one-handed mark, couldn't do so, was put under pressure, taken by Sharon, over to Saywell.
Seventh goal.
Towards the goal, and that's goal number seven.
Now it's Andrews that comes through, does a handball that doesn't really go anywhere, that's what it does, it goes to the wrong player, Robin. Barry Robin's kick goes high, the chance there for North Adelaide coming through hard is Payne, but grabbed by Sonny Morey. Marsh has got a chance, picks it up under pressure, and he puts the ball through. He'll look into the centre. Rodney Robin on his own, get away from BV Andrews. He's got a chance to clear them right into goal. He does. There's a chance for Von Berto. As they bear down him, Von Berto held his ground nicely. If Murray and Bill Cockrum there, he could do something with this one. Should goal with it. It's through the centre. North had a long last of goal. They've got 15 goals now, 15-12. They trail Central Districts 21-11.
Robin runs around Sonny Murray on the mark. One bounce, delivers the ball deep into the forward pocket. Barry Hurls there. Central Districts in the last three quarters. Hurl's kick is a beauty too, and that's a goal to North Adelaide.
Best image of the day by Andrews has stopped Barry Robin. As the siren goes, North Adelaide, Central Districts defeating North Adelaide 21-13 to North Adelaide 16-13. They've won the first game at Football Park. Central Districts certainly deserve this win today.
Can we start really early with maybe your first game of footy?
My first game of footy was we played Glenelg at the only oval.
Oh, I'm going back further than that. What about your first game of footy? I think it's grade three. I think we're talking
about grade three. Of course, McLaren Flat Primary School was pretty limited in numbers, and they had to keep going down the classes to get the 18 players. So I played that day. I played at full forward. The ball didn't come down all day. I never got a touch. But it, I had a great time, and that was the start of my career.
Probably the only time you didn't get a touch in your entire career.
Well, probably. Probably was. Yeah.
But it was a sign that you, I mean, you were playing country footy. McLaren Flat was, well, you tell us. What, you know.
Well, I came to a town to go to school at Erbray when I was 12, and we hadn't had any football in the country because there was no football. It was only A and B grade, no underage. But that first year I came to town, I played a few games for Erbray, but then they decided they would have an under 14s team, and it was started halfway through the year. So I went back and played there, and then the next year I'd played under 14s at McLaren Flat, and we won the premiership, I think. So that was pretty good. That was the start of it.
Taken by Noonan. Mike Noonan sets sail for home with a good long kick down ground. Looking for Graham, finds him. Away goes Graham. He's going away from Ead. Kicks it over forward towards Barton. A good kick. Barton plays on quickly. Has a snap at the goals. Is the score all right? What is it? It's a major. taken by Watman.
Wayne Watman.
Very slick. Long penetrating kick. It'll go through. Cross there, taking it as Sims. Sims playing well in this game. Kicks over towards the centre-half. Lovely kick to position. Here's the chance for Michael Graham. He's got the goals dead in front of him. He can't miss, and he doesn't miss.
Here's the chance for Michael Graham. Gets back. He has a look. Steers it up there, but he's taken it too far. Wild's got it. He's kicked it through for a goal. And Stern have gone back to the lead. Stern lead 3-3 to Ports 2-5.
Plump's got Phillips to contend with. He got past him very well, did Robert Plump. Started his career on a half-back flank, playing at the treacherous centre-half forward position. The kick is through for a goal!
What was it like when you got down to Alberton to play? You started in 1968.
Oh, it was really exciting. Probably a bit nervous because you'd watch these big men play. Fortunately, played 1 year of A grade up in the Riverland and actually played against Malcolm Hill because Malcolm was captain coach of Berry, yes, and running the Berry Hotel. So I had a little bit of influence there, and he taught us a few lessons about don't take too many marks against Berry, otherwise things will happen. And then, of course, Jack Odie got Malcolm to come down to the finals. So we thought, gee, we've played against him while he's at Berry and we're at Wakery, and now Jack Odie's invited him down to play in the final series. And that happened in 68. We went through the season and played Sturt in the grand final. But those first couple of nights at training, I just thought we'd have a few runs and then go back to Wakery in the Riverland or Loxton and be happy with that. But as history shows, 51 years later, it all turned out. We trained and then got invited to play, shot back to Wakery after each training session. And then in those days, Bob McLean was so far in front of every other administrator. We were already playing VFL teams, and we played against Melbourne at Alberton. And then the following year, we would go to Melbourne and play Melbourne. We'd play South Melbourne. In the early 70s, we played Richmond on a yearly basis. We played Preston, the VFA. They were the best team in the VFA, so Bob organised a game against them. So he was just a fantastic administrator, and he organised games against better opposition as trial games. I think to improve us, but also to show us that they were just men, the same as us, and they had nothing special. But also, I think Bob knew that Port Adelaide wanted to play in the best competition. And he certainly was thinking back then about having Port Adelaide play in the very best competition available. And at that time, it was the VFL. So I think that was the forerunner to the national competition way back in the late 60s, early 70s, with Bob McLean, Foss Williams, Davey Boyd, Jeff Motley, and all those thinking ahead about having Port Adelaide up on the centre stage in Australian football, not just being very successful in Adelaide.
Evans vying for the ruck, along with Granger. Evans snaps. Taken here by Belton.
Cunningham it is.
Cunningham it is. Goal.
That is a magnificent goal from that angle, Ian.
Giving him a lead, but he's going to duck round the opposition. Fires one in towards goal. Into the square. Ball comes to ground. Brady there with the opportunity from the edge of the square. He blasts it through. Good effort to Darryl Rady. Weston going for a sprint along the outer side. Two bounces, sets up the short one to Hodgman. He's clear, 30 metres out, settles towards goal, puts it up in the air, and a great goal to the base.
Towards centre half forward, Rady and Warren, and Rady marks, and a quick break away. Rady lining up towards goal. He can get another bounce in. He doesn't want it. He makes no mistake. 3 points to difference. Darryl Rady goals. White drives up long, Caldwell and Evans. Evans from behind. Lethem into the open goal square and dribbles it through, and Port Adelaide have opened it up to 9 points once again.
Got John Thompson clear. Goes over towards that player on the half-forward line. The Bays need a goal. Won't make the distance in the square. Fuller sets himself. They fly. Jackson off the pack. Snaps truly. I think he's got a goal. 7 minutes of time on. Port Adelaide. There it is. Taps it to Adamson, shoots out the short pass, Sanders in defence, Adler however, Casey right there, goes down, taps it now to Gallagher, shoots towards goal. Goal! Lord got off to a brilliant start.
Turbul on the end of it, straightens up, the pass goes to Craig, he's got time to steady, he has a shot at the goal, it's well on its way, and Mill Craig, the mighty Norwood Rover, posts his first goal at the 2 minute mark of the final term. Looking for help, can't get it, doubles back, has a shot at goals, it could be number three. A magnificent goal from Philip Heinrich of Sturt. Puts it out to Noonan, walks there, up comes Adler. Looking for help, can't get it, he's got around, can't get through however. Hits it over to Turbul and Turbul runs into an open goal. Goal number one goes on the board to the Norwood Rover.
Sanders in there, players can hardly scratch themselves at the moment. Turbul heads in towards the open goal again. I think he's got the second. Gives the run of the ball to Bennett. Bennett gets caught to Barton. To Downs it is. Downs smothered off the boot. Winter slips it over to Bergen into the open goal. Sturt got the lead back again. Over the top, Gallagher coming through Turbul, but Boston's got a free kick to Gallagher. Oh, what a time to get a free kick.
Vivian handing the ball like a hot potato at the moment as Jonas decides to have a snap at goal and post one straight through the middle.
Well, Anfaletic plays on, puts it out into the open space. Here's the youngster again. Abernathy's got plenty of time with one bounce. Well shepherded Cunningham, puts the ball up high, beats it back, and a perfect bit of football. Sets it up, Renee Van Dommel. Sorrell's been drawn right away. That's the way the handball goes. Bruce Stevenson in strife. He recovers quickly, slams it straight through the middle.
A tumble punt as Port make an interchange. Eckerman makes an error. Stevenson straight through him. Hoffner putting the ball out wide. Stolen by Jonas. The left foot snap at goal. Looks a beauty.
Clears himself out of strife though with a long drop punt. Here again, a one-on-one battle. A great score by McKay. Picked up by Philippic. Left boot. Straight through the centre. Goal. 17 goals, 12 Port Adelaide. 13 goals, 10 Central Districts.
A long left footer up towards full forward. And in fact, out the back, a chance for Slattery if it's only got a sit for him. Open goal.
To the face of goals, Cochrane front spot. Slammed away. Picked up beautifully, Paul Harradine. Steve Becker a chance. Settles. Now puts himself under pressure. A series of hand passes. Butler back to Steve Becker. A second chance this time. And he blasts the ball towards the forward pocket. Linky, McKay, a chance. Is this Harradine's fault? Yes, it is. As Cochrane versus Hawkins, picked up by Butler in a quick snapshot. Upset Collins, Slattery, over to Andy Bennett, onto the left boot. Magical football from the Raptors.
They will now definitely go into the grand final.
Mossop against Rendell. Michael Ace reads it well. Coming in for Victoria there was Hawker, can't get the kick away. Thomas to the half-forward line. Platten further still. A chance, Craig. Bradley on the run. Out comes to Beckler towards that player. Can't quite get there. He's buttering up again. McAdam wants it wide. 40 metres out. Michael Ace further out into the open goal. Go South Australia. Can't miss. Beautifully done.
Peter Motley comes out. Picks it up well. Handball's back to McAdam. McAdam will go long. Copping is there, but can't take the mark. Platten the crumbs. Here's a goal. Two to Platten. Wide it goes to Ace. Here's a chance. Steve Bickler way out in his own. Tries to get around on the left. Then changes to the right. chance. Through it goes. Two goals, Steve Bickler.
There it is, all over. South Australia, their first win on their own soil for 18 years, have run out big winners over Victoria.
And goes to Davies. Brown gives it across to Howard. Goal. Step two in front. 3-2 to 1-2. Off hand to Sims. Luders. Grosser kicks the goal. So Grosser's goal. The winter effect tackle forward to Leonard de Graham. Now he can run all the way. Drop punt is strong and long and home. Grosser. Still Grosser. On the run. Drop punt goal. West Adelaide 4-6-5-4 and Grosser's got two. Ford can't take the mark. Murat playing it with skill. Kicks to the goal square. Beautiful control. So everything's running for them now. Murat. Borchardt runs on. Murat dummies to him. Then goes to Borchardt. Borchardt with an opportunity to score. And the skipper. Fry. Lindner. Should go. Left foot. He has. He tackles. Does it well too. Whittlesey this time. But the handball's not strong enough. Dreher's there. Whittlesey. Motley. Sturt get a goal. They're 8-7. Luders with the run. Pake with the hands. Comes off hands. Brewson. Try that for size. 21 goals. 16 to 16 goals. 12. And West Adelaide have won it.
Moore has got it, 45 metres out. Salmon on the lead. Oh, it's a shocking kick, but it's going in towards Dacos. Trouble South Australia. Dacos settles. Hicks hooks it in towards goal, and I think he's bottled it. Cunningham, a long one out. Here's a chance now for them to go into attack. Well ridden by Watson. Watson gets it over to Wilson. In turn, it's given across now to Buckley. Heads for the open goal, and the Vicks have got number three on the board. Steadies, 55 metres out. Puts it up in the air. Motley at the back of the pack. It's a magnificent mark.
55 metres. Roberts puts kick on the way. Now it's falling short in the square. The big leap on Kernahan. Off the ground. It's a goal. Up goes Salmon, still in ruck. The handball comes clear out to Bradley. Through it goes. Oh, Roberts kick not good. Gee, I've never seen him kick that poorly. Off the ground again, Kernahan.
Field or Motley under pressure. Wilson could be a mistake. Big Moore looking for Salmon. Hooks round the corner. The big fella's getting back. Could bounce through goal.
Out it comes to Gerard Healy. Here's a chance. Bernie Evans hooks it around the body. Paul Salmon underneath the ball. The siren's gone. The mark will not be paid. What a great spectacle here at Football Park. Victoria 16-12 have defeated South Australia 16-8. Thomas from 50 metres out. What a great kick. That's a goal.
experience let him down on that occasion. In front, Winter, Evans, goal! Well,
Curtis works hard, gets the handball over to Michael Annie. Here's a chance to legs. Vardaniga's got it, puts it in long now, getting back on it. Harvey won't make it! Goal! Norwood coming from the clouds, fifth position. Can they make history by winning, being the first in to win it from position five? Russell, open goal, beautifully done, his first. Got it from Bradley. Port Adelaide hit the front in the 84 grand final. Coming to beat it is Vardaniga. He'll need support. Gives it to Payne. Payne jams it onto his boot. Roberts getting back. Up over the top. He's got the ball. He's got the goal. 6 goals, Roberts.
It's all over. The Redlegs have created history. They've won it from fifth spot. The 1984 grand final. 15-10 to 13-13. Victory by 9 points.
Neil Barmer, very happy man.
Snabikla was wearing him fairly close to, and it's in WA's left full forward pocket. Side bottom from behind. A chance off the ground, a snapshot from Watterson. Yes, the first goal for WA.
Up towards a half-back flank, South Australia doing it well there. Comes up to half-forward. That's a good kick to Bradley. Bradley plays on quickly to Thomas. 45 metres out. Thomas straightens up. And there's a major on the board of the South Aussies.
And the smother was OK, but they're not out of trouble yet because 25 is Campbell's shot. Looks OK. It is for Western Australia, but this lets in Craig Bradley. Bradley going around the boundary line. Fred's out. Oh, put it through.
Craig Bradley over the 50-metre line. Goes out further field to Campbell. To Blight. 25 metres out. The screw kick from Malcolm Blight. He has done it again. 4 points.
Nailey now called to play on. Number 20. Fires it in towards half forward. A chance for Platten. That's a good-looking kick from John Platten. That's a magnificent kick over the left shoulder, and South Australia have got their ninth. Richardson for one of his few possessions, but hand passed the wrong way. This is McIntosh, shrugs off the tackle. Left foot kick by McIntosh. That's how easy it is. Motley in front, marked, broke away from two Western Australian defenders. A long hand pass to Cousins, who says thank you kindly. A superb effort by South Australia. 30 goals, 18, 198 to Western Australia's 16, 15, 111.
Peter, 18 years Acton Elg and the leading player with 448 games, an amazing record. How did you start? Who recruited you back in 1971?
I had an uncle that barracked for North Adelaide, and I'd sort of always followed North Adelaide and didn't know much about Glenelg. But when we shifted to Adelaide, we lived in Seaview Downs, which was in the Glenelg area. I was nearly 15, and a guy called Errol Shepley heard on the grapevine that I could play footy. He looked after the under-17s and under-19s at Glenelg, so he asked me out to play in the under-17s, which I did. I had to sit out for 6 games. I lived in the, was going to play for South Warrnambool, which was Hampden League. They were in the Fitzroy's zone. I had to get a clearance from Fitzroy before I could play with the under-17s. And Fitzroy chose not to respond to my application for a clearance. So after 2 requests to clear me to Glenelg, I was automatically cleared. And it was fascinating later on. I had some Fitzroy officials come and approach me if I was interested in playing with Fitzroy, and I said, just don't bother. You kept me out of footy for 6 weeks because you chose not to even respond to a clearance application. So Fitzroy weren't my favourite side because as a 15-year-old, I was so keen to play footy and had to sit out for 6 weeks. So that was my start at Glenelg. I wasn't really recruited. My dad made sure we lived in the area, and it was sort of must have been destiny to play for Glenelg. First game was against Dean Farnham, and he was 6'9". I did okay, and I think I kicked a goal and got a few kicks, and that was my start of my league career, was against Centrals at Elizabeth.
Did you start in the ruck? You mentioned Dean Farnham. Were you in the ruck, or were you centre forward? Or where
I sort of started in the ruck. I played a few games in the ruck, and then we had a couple of other big fellas, and Curls thought I probably could play ruck rover, so played in the ruck mostly in my first year, and I played, I think, 10 or 11 games in my first year, because I'd played under-19s and reserves prior to making my league debut, so I think about 11, mostly in the ruck. And then the second year, I ruck roved and changed with Cornsey in the second year, so I used to play on the half-forward flank, changing as ruck rovers, and the only problem I had with that was Cornsey didn't like changing too often, so I spent a lot of time on the half-forward flank, which was fine. Cornsey was a great player, well-established, and I actually made the state squad in 72, and there was a couple of youngsters that actually made the state team that started the same year as me, and I think they were, it might have been Neil Button and Terry Moore, and it was the carnival in Perth, and I was absolutely filthy with Curls that I didn't get in that squad. He reckons I wasn't quite ready, so that was playing as a ruck rover, and then in 1973, I started playing centre-half forward. I'm not sure how Curls saw, that was going to be my spot. I always played centre-half forward as a junior before I went to Glenelg. So I loved playing centre-half forward. I think it's probably one of the hardest positions to play on the ground, but one of the best positions when you're playing well, and a fantastic position when you've got good players in front of you. And I certainly had some great players that played in front of me at Glenelg when I was playing centre-half forward. And 73 was just an amazing year for the club, for me. I think I ended up kicking 70-odd goals that year from centre-half forward. In a great side. We lost one game for the year, so not a bad spot to be playing centre-half forward when you've got the likes of Rexy Voigt, Kerry Hamilton, Wayne Phillis, Cornsey, Peter Marker, kicking the ball to you, so it was pretty easy.
North Adelaide will try and run it out. They do, in fact, through Worley. Up it goes to Bennett. He plays it up now. Here goes Robertson. He's one of the fastest players you'll ever see. He runs through half forward. That ball's coming back. Oh, it's a goal. Robertson's got the first one of the game.
Changes tack. He's going to get one down. Look, down he goes. A vicious tackle. A punch tackle. Up comes Antrobus. Maynard. Simons wants it, but it's going in towards Gardon. Big fella up. Simons going to get the crumbs. That's one tackle. Slips it out. Coughing. Ought to be a goal. Open goal coming up. Fine shot. Beautiful handball.
Parsons will take the tap for North Adelaide. No, really it'll be. Carey. Shot the handball out. Hart off the ground. Williams kicked a goal. Hart.
Dumped away there by Henwood. North Adelaide a chance. Antrobus whips out a handball. Open goal. Lay down the Zamp. Sanders. Bennett could. Tiller can. Open goal. 30 metres out. Fine goal.
Armfield. Garton again. Oh, he's got pace. Comes around beautifully, Garton. Great goal from the big chap. That's his second. Gee, North Adelaide had the chance, but it's going straight back the other end. Maynard plays on, straight through the centre. Scores the level.
Paul Kernahan at the back of the pack, the big fella up again. Can't get this one. A snapshot away. Coppock, I think he's got it. Oh, what a magnificent goal.
Parsons, Carey over the top. Running it on open. Goal is Hart.
Wobbles one towards that player. Out comes Kernahan. Kernahan 30 metres out, gets round and shoots. That looks home. Oh, what a goal, Stephen Kernahan.
A big turnaround. Kernahan just gave him one back. And he gave a big one back too. Well, it's on now.
Here's the Stouse.
The players want to get involved. I tell you what, David Wilde is still on the ground. He's not quite sure what day it is. Here it is. Glenelg win it. 21-15 to North Adelaide, 12-12.
Want to want to see South Australia avenge the defeat that Bob just told you about last year. McDermott, 40 metres out on the way. Fine goal. Played on, or did he? Swooping on it, Bradley. The umpire says it's played on. Walsh got the tap away, but it went to Aish. Drives South Australia into attack up towards the half-four line. Chance Kernahan as he goes through the pack. Slips it out, Naley. Open goal, could not miss. South Australia's fourth goal.
Bolton on to McDermott. Back to Bolton in the 1-2. Good build-up. Aish, 35 metres out. Brilliant goal. Oh, what a top goal. Michael Aish, his first.
South Australia through Naley. Now Kernahan. Kernahan, 45 metres out, goes for home, he's got it! Finally, it's got out from Bolton. Here's a chance, McGuinness on the run, he goes for home, and he's bottomed it! Oh, what a goal, South Australia! Merritt over the top, down there is Kernahan, Platten shoots in towards goal, this is going to be close, oh, what a goal! Sensational goal, Platten! But I can't, there's the siren! South Australia have done it! A magnificent win to the home side! 40,000 fans plus go wild here at Football Park. South Australia hugging one another. A brilliant victory. They were down by 8 points at quarter time. Two at half time. A brilliant 8-goal third quarter burst saw them 19 points in front at three quarter time. And they've hung on to edge Victoria out by 10 points. Swarz behind in the bomber. Swarz, Max Parker, the big fella out now, gives a chance here as the ball goes in towards full forward. Getting back in defence, it's Kinnear. I think he kicked out on the full. Yes, it definitely was out on the full under pressure. And the free kick goes to Suri, plays on, shoots for goal, and he popped it through. Brilliantly done, Zip Zap.
He looks in pretty fine frettle, actually. This is his third kick. Jags that one back, Darren Smith. That's the second or third mark that he's dropped. Jennifer picks up the crumbs, aims it at goal, and boots it. Now Russell Boyd hooks around the corner. Dwayne Russell will mark it and play on. Boyd, in fact. Greg Boyd it is. A chance, Woodville. Zip-zap, away he goes, onto the left boot. He's done it again. Zip-zap's kicked his second.
Jolly through the half-forward line, puts out the pass. Nichols! He's going to play on, open goal, puts it through. His first goes in long, he puts it up in the edge, it's a huge kick. This could go through, a goal! There's got to be a 4-4 goal out there, they're kicking them from everywhere.
Mark number three, gone short for Nichols, Nichols to goal! From Haylock is high, Leslie on, Nichols off the ground, yes! Yes! Oh, you saw it by the goal! In the square, Silla, he's kicked three, here's his four, into the open goal he goes.
Haylock as he kicks it around the corner, Taylor, he comes in and he lines it up, he's put it through.
The big fellow gets his hands on it, can't complete it, Grant. Harris uses Curtis as a doormat, goes for home with a long one, and he's put it through. Oh, what a brilliant goal.
That kick didn't quite work. There's Nichols again, he drags it back.
The final score, Woodville 18 goals 20, 128, defeat at Port 18 goals 13, 121, the margin 7 points.
Kicking it up towards Nichols, uses the body well, big chance now as Martin goes through, he virtually had to throw it out, he gave it to Nichols though, who better to give it to, he puts it through for his first goal. Chance now, offhands it comes, Clayton Lamb running into an open goal, and Clayton Lamb has got it to put West Adelaide in front. Back it goes towards centre, but it comes back again, or Burgess made the error. Through goes Rousseau, scoops it out, great work Rousseau, he gave it over to Haylock, and he puts it through for his second goal.
Bloods to go forward again, put it up high towards Toomey at half forward, now it's Clayton Lamb. Important shot this from Lamb from 45 metres. He's got the distance okay, and I think he's popped it through.
Back there, siren's gone. West Adelaide have done it. They've got up to win by 4 points. Robbed the Warriors for their first big win in history. But a great gutsy performance by both sides sees West Adelaide run out winners in the 1987 Escort Cup, 6-14 to 7-4.
McDermott puts it forward, coming to meet it, Mandermaker in trouble, needs support. Oh, Naley's there to give it to him. Naley from half forward, hooks towards goal, he's got it. Oh, great stack from Naley, six kick, first goal, brilliant effort. Naley on the ground again at centre half forward, boots it in towards goal, this could be his second, he's got it. Kernahan sandwiched out of it. McGuinness on the ground, under pressure from Schimmelbusch. Langford's kick to Naley, he's already been at two, make that three. Superb performance, Mark Naley.
He appeared to be legged, but umpire Kinnear was on the spot. Didn't give the free kick. That Tommy Naley. He's going to kick four. Oh, he is. He's kicked four goals in one corner.
Towards the half back line. I think that was Ruse. Here's a chance. Stretch winds his way through the pack. Now it was Langford. I think this is a goal. Brilliantly done, Stephen Stretch. Well shepherded in the square there by South Australia. With him back there is Ayres. Oh, that's pretty slow to get rid of it. The umpire said play on. Here's a chance. Anderson gets it out. McGuinness, 45 metres out, shoots for goal. And I think he bumped it through. Comes back in field up towards full forward. Setting himself as Ruse. Can't quite bring it down. He's still in there fighting for the footy. Trying to get it out now. Shot away. Glasgow, I think. Osborne it is. Goal. Brilliantly done. One straight kick the difference.
Peek's got a couple of bad bounces of late. Andrew Jarman has waited back, gave it to his brother Darren Jarman, now Ross Gibbs. As I said, loves to kick goals. That is evidence of that fact. He used the body to get rid of his opponent. He gave it over there to Salisbury, who goes long for South Australia, putting his hand on it down there and kicking it off the ground was Ross Gibbs. Jump for it, but miss it. It was Taylor to Painter. And Painter from about 50 metres out. Spears one through.
Behind it's Abernathy breaking away for South Australia around the outer side. Abernathy bloodied. Breaks towards centre wing. Crosses that. Goes down towards half forward. The long kick into the forward line. Knocked away by Campbell. Mandermaker's got it. Gets the hand pass to Harris. 25 metres out, Harris. That's a fine snapshot from there. There's the siren. Mercifully for Western Australia. It's been a disappointing night tonight. Western Australia going under. That's for West Australian fans, of course. 9-9 to 18-16.
Murphy, the star from last week. Maynard's gone. Down the ground he goes. Oh, that's a high tackle. It will be a Glenelg free kick at half back. A Glenelg player on the ground. Bang, they go. Oh, in comes Redden and down goes Kernahan. And in comes Wayne Stringer and she's on. Alan Stringer, they're gone berserk. Opening minutes and it's really on. In goes Alan Stringer. Out goes Clisby. On all over the place at the moment.
After all, there is a game to be won out there. And a quick kick away by Sims. He's got a goal.
Parsons provides a shepherd. Well, that's a hard one. Off goes Darren Jarman. Around the line, puts it on its way. There's still a fight going. That's a goal.
You can't blame him. They're having another go. Parsons. Here's a go, Roberts. Roberts has kicked for goal. Through goes Darren Jarman. Can he kick another one? What a great goal, Darren Jarman.
Bennett with a chance now. Cleverly to Sims. Sims can't get it out. Oh, yes, he can to Jarman. Jarman slips it. Burton, he bolts. Heads it on its way. That's a goal!
North Adelaide, but he's got a few good mates there. Well intercepted. Winton tore through that. Got it to Gibbs in the pocket. Oh, fumbles. Takes it. Plays on. Here's a go for the Bays. Over the top to Seabo, and they've got one. Well, his handball is not a good one. Sims could be murdered in there, but he got it on beautifully to Burton. Here he goes, the racehorse. Look at him go. 30 metres and closing, and he goes.
Sims. A bit of a terrier there, Sims. He's lost a boot. He applies a tackle. Umpire didn't see it. Darren Jarman takes off. Oh, what a great goal. That's his third.
Darren Jarman. His brother's well clear. Out in front of him. Can Grenvold raise a gallop to get to him? He shoots for goal, and that's home again. Oh, what a shot. 20th kick, Michael Noonan even allows himself a smile. Walking on water is easy compared to this. And there it is. The hoodoo is over. The monkey has been laid to rest. And North Adelaide in 1987 have run out magnificent winners. Schwartz gets it over, pulling out of Tottenham. The Warriors run it, put a long one up towards full forwards. Stevens again. Nichols open goal. The Warriors have got their second.
First quarter, great game of football here. 10 sports action. Klug gets it out. Here's another chance for the Warriors. Oh, he's put it onto his left foot and slammed it through. I think it was Haylock.
Harrison hooks around the corner. Hines comes to meet it. The bounce could decide. Here's a chance hooking around the corner. Now his ball lays. He's going to bounce through. Put it later on the board. Three North, three Warrior footballers back there. Can't get it. Here's a chance. Hines again.
Moving machine compared to Port Adelaide, but that doesn't matter. The Magpies back in business. Klug through half forward onto the left boot. Could this be a quick reply? What a great goal, John Klug.
Detman again. Kerb butters up. Leslie there out to Borlase. Borlase hooks. Going to be shy on distance, or is it? It's a goal. I think it's a goal. Will Wade. Goal. Well read, Arvin. Gets it out now. Templeton hooks around the corner. Loose ball. Klug. Shocking bounce. This could bounce through. I think that's a goal. An unbelievable goal.
Quick kick away or danger. Templeton. Open goal. Under the boot. There it goes.
Siren's gone. The Warriors have done it. History has been created in the 1988 Escort Cup. The Warriors have won their first major title. They are Escort Cup winners in 1988.
Lays it off to Williams, a long one. Hodges on the long lead. Oh, that is brilliantly done. He'll shoot from 45, favours the right-hand post. Good-looking kick. His sixth goal, Scott Hodges.
And Sentry. Now Tregenza, this brilliant youngster. It's a high one. Hodges again. This time it's two against one. And Smith goals! Two against one the other way. Melican, who's just come on, lumbers after it. He goes in short to Fidge, and he's found the full forward. 35 metres out. And he's got it.
But Seabone in the way. He hands it off to Doofy, who provides good rebound. Ugh. Gets around Wanganeen. Was that intentional? We may never know. A long one. The centre-half forward, Christie in the way, and he'll get the free kick. 40 metres out, time running out for the Bays. He pops it up. Good-looking kick, comes back, and he's put it through. His first goal. No, I was going to say a minute away, but the 1990 premiership to Port Adelaide. Winners by 15 points. Scott Hodges and Tim Ginnivan fall to the ground. A third consecutive grand final for Port Adelaide, and also coach John Cale. The final score, Port Adelaide 16-12, 108, Glenelg 13-15, 93.
I was given the approval to have discussions with the West Torrens Football Club on the possibility of a merge. So I rang Rex and outlined to him what I would like to do, and invited him to my house. I lived only 100 metres from Woodville Oval in Glen Huntley Street, just around the corner. So I invited him to my house, and we had, I think, two or three meetings, just the two of us, where we were able to, with no commitment. I mean, Rex, if this falls over at our third meeting, so be it. If it falls over at our second meeting, so be it. But let's just continue to talk with no firm commitment. So we'll talk about what if. It's what if we do it? Where will we play? What if we do it? What will our colours be? What if we do merge? What should we call the club? What if we do merge? What will happen with the staff? What if we do merge? Who should coach? So all of those what ifs, we were able to pretty much thrash out ourselves and take back to our clubs.
The spirit of going to Woodville Oval now, even when Woodville West Torrens, there's something about going to that ground and club, isn't it?
It's a great place to watch sport, and it's a great sporting sort of precinct with the tennis and the bowls and all the other that's just in that area. And I like going back there. It's a nice part of town.
Beautifully done, Nick Pesch. Look at the pace as he
Here he comes, in short. Beautifully done.
Sat on the bench for three quarters, but he's now got something to talk about.
Oh, he has now.
By the way, to an Eagles fan in the last two seasons, something about the Neil Baum sacking that he didn't like at Nord, and he now follows the Eagles. And look at Zilla, he's everywhere.
Perhaps only their mum could have picked that one as they came along. Here's Jason. Pretty good. Straight through, his second. And by blessed, I mean in his first year of senior coaching. He has inherited a side of enormous skill and talent as it goes towards Kluzek. Just took the eyes off the ball as Burns was coming.
Bruce Winter has taken that extra step further.
No argument with that as Kluzek fires away at the goals. As St. Michael's College graduate would be very pleased with that.
Modra gets free, winds his way out of the pack. Oh, beautifully stolen. Pest from 40. What a super bit of individual football. And that just tells you what day the Red Legs have had.
Yes, it's something you'd like to do. It's an Eagles supporter.
Yes. There's the siren to end the 1993 Grand Final. And the Eagles have dominated the day. They go out winners by 73 points.
They've blocked the Eagles' corridor of power.
Growl from 52 punches it up.
Oh!
It was a touch. I don't think it was. It's the first goal of the Eagles.
And if they can get up, they can hold on here and they can get up. Coach Peter Jonas, and they're going to probably have another ping at it here with Daniel Healy. Could this seal a premiership for the Bulldogs? Their first ever. What a significant moment. Healy has a look and kicks it. Central District have just about got it, I reckon, the 2000 Grand Final. They go to 8-10. The Eagles are 5-6 and they're crippled. They're in real trouble, the Eagles, now.
This will be the last, virtually last kick in the game. Up high, McArdle over the back. A quick handball across. He's got the pace. The Lager. Checkside has hit the post. Oh, that really would have had the fans over the fence.
Sorry, and there it is. Centrals have won the 2000 Grand Final. First time this century.